Wake up everybody, no more sleeping in bed.
Hey, Ufat. I am the executive director of the New Georgia Project and the New Georgia Project Action Fund. And I'm really, really, really happy to be in community with you all today. And our brother to the left, you want to introduce yourself?
Hi, my name is Khalid. I am a councilman in the new city of South Fulton. We are Atlanta's new twin city and the blackest city in America.
So I'll say this. We live in some very interesting times, and Georgia is an interesting place. I spend a lot of time traveling and telling people that Georgia is America's newest swing state, and I'm really, really proud. And so when presidential candidates come through, having an opportunity to have substantive, meaningful conversations about things that matter to Georgians, I think is critical and it's key. And so I'm really, really happy to have you all join us this afternoon. I'll just say this. The New Georgia Project has registered almost 350,000 people of color in all 159 of Georgia's counties. And I bring that up because we don't just register people to vote, that every single person that we register to vote, we also engage them in a substantive conversation about the hopes that they have for themselves, their families, their communities, about the fears and the concerns that they have for themselves, their families, and their communities. And, you know, it is clear that healthcare is on the top of most Georgians' minds. The idea that there's a profit motive that drives the healthcare industry, the fact that we have 12 hospitals in rural Georgia that are slated to close, that 78 out of Georgia's 159 counties do not have OBGYNs at all. The minimum wage in Georgia is $5.15, right? And that many of us have lived through the nightmare of an election in 2018 where we saw how to steal an election and get away with it and have the national media throw their hands up and look surprised that another Republican stole an election. And so when we start thinking about what the blueprint for winning looks like, what the blueprint for a bold agenda looks like, a blueprint for maintaining and protecting the integrity of our elections, that's when all of the people in this room come into play. And so I'm hoping that throughout our questions that you bring your campaigns, your communities, your hopes, your fears into the room, and we engage in a substantive conversation with Senator Sanders. I'm truly honored to be your moderator today.
So I've been tasked with giving an introduction to a man who needs no introduction. I do want to say that in addition, though, to registering tens of thousands of voters, hundreds of thousands of voters, that the New Georgia Project also makes sure that voters with names like Khalid Kamau and Michelle Rodriguez or Krupesh Patel or Nse Ufas, that we don't get purged from the voting roll. So thank you so much for that. So I was a member of this union, CWA. I was also a member of the transit union, ATW. I was a MARTA bus driver driving paratransit, the elderly and the disabled in 2015. And MARTA came up with this brilliant idea that they would save money by laying all of us off, laying 300 drivers and mechanics off, so that they would be able to get out of our union contract and not have to pay for healthcare benefits. I saw grown adults crying who were months away from being vested, that lost their pension, that lost healthcare for themselves and their families. And around that time, I heard about this old white guy from Vermont who was saying, these corporations are just getting out of control and income inequality is getting ridiculous. And I was like, I wanna be involved with that campaign. But long before I knew who Bernie Sanders was. This man was building the bandwagon that many so-called progressives today are hopping on. He's been building it for decades. We know that when our current president and his father were working hard to keep African Americans out of their properties in New York City, this man was in Chicago getting arrested with Martin Luther King fighting for fair housing. We know that he stood against deregulating banks, which in the 2007 Great Recession, African Americans lost half of our wealth, right? He has been fighting to decriminalize marijuana and decriminalize this justice system that have been locking a lot of our fathers and brothers and mothers up, and a host of other things. I could go on and on. But I think the most important thing, and it's the reason that I'm here and the reason that other people in this room are here, is that he ran a courageous campaign, not just for himself, but to get all of us involved. And Senator Sanders, I want to say thank you. You are the reason that I am a city councilman. This year, not 2020, this year, there will be over 1,200 races here in the state of Georgia for city council, county commission, school board. And we want to make sure that everyone, before you leave out of this room, you're connected with an organization, whether it's the Democratic Socialists of America we meet here, or any of the other organizations in this room. Make sure that you're connected and that you're involved in a campaign, not in 2020, but this year. And so with that, I'm going to turn it over to Ms. Ufok to ask the first question.
Let me thank you all for coming here. And as you have heard, we are living in unprecedented times. That's all. We've had bad presidents in the history of this country, but never quite someone like Trump, who has disdain for the Constitution of the United States, who is literally trying to turn one group of people against another group of people, who is a very hateful human being who thinks that he is going to grow politically stronger based on the hatred that he is espousing. So the disagreement of what this campaign is about is not just, you know, we believe in healthcare for all and Medicare for all. It's about literally whether we're going to retain our democracy. It's whether or not these little children who are in the room here today are going to be living in a planet that is healthy and habitable. Because you know what Trump does not know, and that is that climate change is very real. And if we don't get our act together, you know, the scientists are talking about 11 or 12 years before there is irreparable damage to this entire planet. So that's why we're going to go forward with the Green New Deal, which creates millions of good-paying jobs, making this country and world more energy efficient, moving to sustainable energies, wind, solar, etc. So this is it. We are fighting in this election for the future of America, and that is just not empty phraseology. On one hand, if we lose this election, we're looking at more authoritarianism. We're looking at the undermining of American democracy. You just talked to Stacey Abrams last night, and you're right. It would be Governor Abrams if there were a fair election process here in Georgia. In Tennessee, you know what they're doing in Tennessee? All right, you know what they're doing in Tennessee. All right, what they're doing in Tennessee, you know, what we have historically done is we have worked to register voters, and we've had organizations. And now what they're trying to do is saying if you're sending in a certain number of applications which have this or that mistake, somebody spelled his name differently, you are criminally responsible. So who the hell is going to go out registering voters if you're going to end up in jail? In New Hampshire, don't think this is just people of color. In New Hampshire, virtually all white state, they're working overtime to make it harder for young people to vote. All right? These people cannot win an election on their ideas because nobody believes in tax breaks for billionaires and cuts to education and Social Security. The only way they win is trying to suppress the vote. So we are fighting for democracy. We're fighting for the future of the planet. We're fighting for health care for all people. And man, we cannot sit this one out. This is the future of our country and the future of the planet. So thank you for being here. Let's get going.
Again, Senator Sanders, my name is Gabriela Solis, and I am an undocumented student at Freedom University. Freedom U is an underground school for undocumented students like me who are banned from equal access to public higher education in Georgia. As of now, we can legally drive to our low-wage jobs and pay our taxes, but we are denied equal access to higher education and the right to vote. Thank you for supporting the DREAM Act in the past. However, the DREAM Act would provide a pathway to citizenship for only 10% of the undocumented population. It would protect me and my fellow students, but not our parents, who we consider to be the original dreamers. What does fair, comprehensive immigration reform look like to you? And what will you do to protect the full human rights of all 11 million undocumented immigrants living in this country if elected president?
Is Gabriel here? What up? This is a brave young lady, and we thank her very much. And all I will say is two things. First of all, I believe that in America, higher education is a right of all people. Okay. Many of you, how many people in this room are dealing with student debt? There you go. Okay. And some of them are dealing with outrageous levels of student debt. All right. So we're trying to do two things: make public colleges and universities tuition free for all people, including this young lady. Okay. And very substantially reduce student debt for everybody. All right, I don't want you to be burdened with student debt for the next 20 or 30 years, okay? So in terms of immigration reform, the path is pretty clear. You're right, it's not just immediate legal status to protect you and 1.8 million other people eligible for the DACA program. It is to move as quickly as we can to comprehensive immigration reform and a path towards citizenship for all. And here's the good news. Despite Trump and his demonization, what I just said about comprehensive immigration reform, that is supported by a very, very strong majority of the American people. 80% of the people think that you should have legal protection today. All right. So we should not think that everybody in America agrees with Trump. He is representing a small minority. And I'll tell you what else he is doing. He is doing what demagogues always do. What is that? What do demagogues historically do all over the world?
Dehumanize.
Well, they dehumanize. What else do they do?
Separate and divide.
They pick on minorities. Mm-hmm. They're very tough. They're in the majority. So in Europe, it could be Jews. It could be gypsies. It could be Latinos, it could be gay people, it could be black people, depending on the circumstance. That's what demagogues always do. And they say, it's his fault that you don't have a job or decent wages. It's her fault that you don't have any health care, because we're spending all the money on her. That's what demagogues always do. Nothing new. Trump is not smart enough to come up with a new idea. All right, we're just seeing it in America, and these are the people who are being demonized. So it is imperative, you know, just in the same way that we got this horrible legislation from Alabama, all right, that men stand with women, those of us who were born in the United States, stand with undocumented, whites stand with black, straight stand with gay, all right, that's what it's about. He wants to divide us up. And if we don't let them do that, we're going to win this election and win it big. Okay?
All right, so we have the chair of Democratic Socialists of Atlanta here.
And he has the next question. We have many questions about reparations.
I'm going to apologize that I don't have a whole lot of time. I don't know what we're going to have to head down to Birmingham, but let's go. Let's see what we got.
Okay. So his question is, my name is Gregory McKelvey. I was a delegate for you in the 2016 DNC. Recently, I became the subject of attacks by some of your most fervent supporters when I dared to question your priorities in regards to race. I believe, as Martin Luther King, that capitalism and racism are tied together and you cannot get rid of one without the other. So my question to you is, do you believe that your economic proposals are enough to remedy the impact of white supremacy, or does institutionalized supremacy deserve its own policies? And then finally, what are you willing to say to your supporters who attack people who ask these questions?
I don't want anyone to be attacking anybody. I mean, I just mentioned earlier, we've got to stand together. Okay, we got enough to take on Donald Trump and his billionaire friends and his racism and his sexism and his homophobia. So we don't need to be arguing. You know, we can disagree respectfully. That's fine. Argue respectfully. But we don't need to be attacking we don't need to be attacking anybody. All I can tell you in response to your question is that the agenda that I have brought forth is probably the most progressive agenda in the history of the United States of America. And I can respect that people say, do more. All right, that's fine. But what I have to do is bring forth an agenda that works for working people and at the same time wins an election. And that's what I intend to do. So if people are unhappy that I am leading the effort for Medicare for all, fine. People are unhappy that I've led the effort to raise the minimum wage to a living wage, $15 an hour, fine. Leading the effort or helping to lead the effort on climate change, taking on this whole broken criminal justice system, immigration system. That's the agenda, you mentioned it. And it's agenda, by the way, with your help, that has helped transform politics in America. Think about it. 4 years ago, who was talking about $15 an hour?
Nobody.
All right? And you know what? As of today, 7 states have already passed that legislation. All right? And the U.S. House of Representatives through the... So look, here's the bottom line. It's good to debate. What should we do? What's a progressive agenda? People can disagree with me. But the agenda that I am fighting for, taking on Wall Street, taking on the military-industrial complex, the insurance companies, the drug companies, you know, it is the most progressive agenda in American political history, and I don't apologize for that. Okay?
Our next question is from Benjamin Dixon of the Progressive Army. Justin Amash has come out in favor of impeachment, yet Democratic leadership, including Nancy Pelosi and Chuck Schumer, are not. Where do you stand? And if you are in favor, what the hell is wrong with Dems?
I'll tell you, here is what the issue is. It's a difficult issue. Has Trump committed impeachable offenses? Probably.
Yep.
Even the Mueller report, which said that his campaign did not collude overtly with Russia, left very open the question of obstruction of justice, which is an impeachable offense. So the House is now engaged in very serious investigations on that issue. And I support those investigations. The truth has got to come out. And if they move toward impeachment, they will move toward impeachment. And that's fine with me. But here is my political concern. At the top of my list of to-do things is to make sure that Donald Trump is a one-term president. Because if he is not, I worry very much about the future of this country. Now, and I may be wrong on this. I mean, honest people have different opinions. But here is the fear. I'm not telling you it's going to happen. But you have a nation in which people, including people in this room, are worried about health care. They're worried about decent wages. They're worried about education. They're worried about the environment and climate change. And if, and I'm not predicting this will happen, and I may be wrong, but if the Congress now spends a year talking about impeachment, you're going to have millions of people saying, you're talking about impeachment, I don't have any health care, thank you very much. Yeah, Trump is a problem, I can't afford to send my kids to college. What about me? And it is possible, and again, I don't know the answer, nobody does, that that whole process could work to Trump's advantage. And he goes out and says, everybody is picking on me and all that stuff. Okay? When Bill Clinton was impeached, which was an absurd thing, for his sexual activity, he ended up being far more popular when he came out than when he went in. I don't want to see that for Trump. So that's both sides of that question. Okay?
All right. From the nation back here to Georgia, I got all of the chair questions. The chair of the Democratic Party is here, Senator Nikema Williams.
How are you?
And her question is, what is your specific plan for Georgia in your path to securing the Democratic nomination and the presidency? And I'm going to just ask a follow-up question to that, because we are grateful to have you here today and this weekend, but we want more time here in Georgia. And people like NSAID and New Georgia Project have been working really hard to turn this state. So when can we get you back for a multi-city tour? Come down to Old Nat and have some dinner at Big Daddy's and all of that. We want more time here in Georgia. What's your, how are you going to win Georgia?
I just had lunch at Gus's Fried Chicken, which was very good, I must say. What you guys have done in Georgia is remarkable. And I agree, as I said, with those people who believe that Stacey should be governor if there was not voter suppression. And that didn't happen by accident. She's a great candidate, but it happened because she registered 300,000 people. But who's counting? 350,000. That's extraordinary. That is extraordinary. I don't know, I'm not aware, given the size of the state, that any state has done better than that. And that is exactly what we have to do. So to answer your question, I talked to Stacey last night and I talked to John Lewis this morning. And both of them are of the belief that a Democrat can win here in Georgia, can win here in Georgia. And that is because of the work you guys have done. That would not have been the case a while back. Right? So this is now a battleground state, and that deserves the attention and the resources of the Democratic Party. And you will see me back here. You will see me back here. And I'll tell you for a couple of reasons. Not only because of the work that you've done to make this a battleground state, but I'll tell you something else. I am, as somebody who comes from a white working class family, I lived in a rent-controlled apartment in Brooklyn, New York for the first 18 years of my life. I am tired of seeing white working class people continue to vote against their own best interests. Okay? And we need, whether it is Mississippi, where, if my memory is correct, Barack Obama got 10% of the white vote. And that speaks to very bad work done by Democrats there. 90% of whites in Mississippi are not racist. And we can raise that number from 10 to 25, 30%. You're going to win in Mississippi. We'll do better here in Georgia. We can do it. It's going to take a lot of work. It's going to take resources. Let's bring our people together. Okay, a couple more questions.
I'm going to ask my question, which was, we saw you do a phenomenal job yesterday. We had a voter registration drive in Augusta. And you took a moment to talk to 2016 voters who voted for Trump. My question is, with the fact that Secretary Clinton got 3 million more voters than President Trump, and that we saw a depression in the number of people of color, voters of color, young voters, unmarried women, what is your specific message for non-voters and people who opted out and who didn't participate at all?
Great question. All right, here's what I think. This is how I think I win, and actually how other Democratic candidates can win. Because there are some really, good candidates out there. I kind of think I'm the best, but there are other good candidates. And it's a combination of two things. It's number one, getting our base enthused about politics, bringing people into the political process. Here is a simple statement of fact. If young people under 30 voted at the same percentage as the rest of the general population, this country would be a radically different country, and you would not have that moron in the White House or Republican control of the U.S. Senate. Okay? Now, we are making, you know, in the 2016 campaign, I worked as hard as I can to bring people in, young people. And we've had success with other people. You guys have done a phenomenal job, all right? But we need to do that. We need to focus on young people. We need to focus on working class people and grow the turnout. The second thing we need to do, it's not an either or. Somebody said, why are you talking to Trump's people? Why don't you do this? We got to do both. We can chew bubble gum and walk at the same time. So we want to grow the base. I was in South Carolina yesterday talking to some young people. And they go out and they talk to their friends. Their friends don't understand politics, don't understand the significance of politics. They can't pay off their student debt, but they're not interested in politics. They don't have any health care, they're not interested in politics. And we got to turn that around. The second thing is Trump, who is a pathological liar, lied to people who voted for him during the campaign. He said to people, you're sitting somewhere in Michigan or Wisconsin, you can't afford health care. Well, your job went to China. And he said, I hear your pain. I'm going to provide health care to everybody. Well, truth is he tried to throw 32 million people off of health insurance. Okay? I am not going to cut Medicare or Medicaid or Social Security. Check out his budget. Massive cuts to Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid. Okay? His tax plan. Remember that name? Not going to benefit the wealthy. 83% of the benefits went to the top 1%. Okay? He lied. And it's important to tell his supporters that he lied. And if we win 5 or 10% of them, and if we grow our base, not only do we win by a landslide. And that's what I think the direction has got to be. Okay, maybe one more question and we're going to have to hit the road. I know you got a whole lot.
Yes, I'm going to combine all of these.
All right, questions. There it is.
I'm going to try. So I'm a councilman. I make $13,000 a year. I have $60,000 in student loan debt. So in addition to being a councilman, I rent out rooms on Airbnb. I drive Uber. What can we do to regulate these new gig economy jobs so that
absolutely
they don't become robber barons? And secondly, what can we do beyond free public college around loan forgiveness, particularly for HBCUs and other private
institutions? Absolutely. HBCUs play an enormously important role in higher education in this country. And we are going to give them very, very significant support. And I want to congratulate, you know, all of those institutions that have done so much to give us teachers and doctors and nurses and everybody else. What is going on now is one of the scams that corporate America is running is to say that instead of you being an employee, and I have to provide healthcare benefits to you, a minimum wage to you, and pay payroll taxes, congratulations, you are an independent contractor. Isn't that why you're independent? And that means you can work for $4 an hour. You can put gas in the car. You can do whatever you want to do. And you have no guarantees for us. We have legislation that would essentially wipe that out. We have a thing called legislation, which I will implement as president, called the Workforce Democracy, Workplace Democracy Act. Okay, this is what it does. Three or four main things. First of all, it understands, and I say this in a CWA hall, that one of the reasons we have seen a decline in the middle class over the last 40 years is the decline in trade unionism. All right? All right? Workers can't do it alone. You can't do it alone. You need a group of people to stand up and negotiate a decent contract. So we got to grow the trade union movement. Our legislation says 50% of the people in a bargaining unit plus one sign a card. You got a union. And if the company does not negotiate that first contract, heavy penalties against that employer. Number two, we wipe out Section 14B of the Taft-Hartley Act, which allows for so-called right-to-work legislation. All right? And among other things, we also do away with this farce of independent contractors, where Uber is, among others, in this gig economy, ripping off workers. We give workers protection. All right? I apologize that I have to get going, but we're going to Birmingham, I think, next on this trip. Is that where we're going? Birmingham, all right. But I want to thank you. It's a great turnout on a beautiful Sunday afternoon. Thank you all for coming. We got a lot of work on our hands. What the campaign is about is not just winning the Democratic nomination, not just beating Trump. Our goal is to transform this country and create a government and an economy that works for all of us, not just the 1%. I would very much appreciate your support. Thank you.
We gotta change again, just you and me. Yeah. It's the God hour. The morning I wake up, just for the breath of life, I thank my maker.